we getting for what we're paying for? And then get into the nuts and bolts of the actual analysis. So on a personal note, education at the University of Michigan, my first 2 years of the doctoral program, that was primarily funded through ARC. The last 2 years through the Center for Medicare, CMS. And that was to set up the composite rate for end-stage renal disease, to help set up a system for medical care and how we pay for medical care. Professionally, some of that was already addressed in the introduction. And then personally, I've been married to my wife for some time, four kids now, a 6'4", almost 2, and a month old, and it's good stuff. So, to get into the information for today, in 1960, we spent $28 billion on healthcare. That translates to $148 per person. Now, to put that in context, the average price of a new home in 1960 was just under $13,000. Car, $2,600. Average salary, just over $4,000.
Sorry, and that $148 per person is annually, right?
Yeah, yeah. That translates to 5.2%. That was back to 1960. If we fast forward 50 years, the numbers are dramatically different, right? So we've gone from $28 billion to over $3 trillion. We've gone from $148 per person to just under $10,000. That number is going to grow at 17.5% of GDP. That's projected to be up over 20% within the next 2 or 3 years. And then again, you've got the comparisons. New home, $337,000, car at $34,000, and the average salary at $46,000. Makes sense, you have time value of money, I clearly make more than my grandfather made. Inflation, stuff goes up. If you take a look at the multiplier, right? Salaries have gone up 11.5 times. The car, maybe a little bit more. Housing, healthcare, right? So something's going on with healthcare that's driving up the cost. And when we take a look at the outcomes, we're not necessarily getting what we want, right? So this is from the Commonwealth Fund, and you see the countries on the top. Low numbers are good, big numbers are bad, right? So when you see one, that's the ranking. So if you see a one, they are the top among the countries that we're looking at. And you see, we spend a ton of money, and we're not necessarily getting much for it. We see a lot of 11s relative to some of these other countries. Now, some of that may be a fact of how we pay for care. Historically, it's been a fee-for-service type of arrangement, where every time you go in and use a service, you're paid for that individual service. And so we have dollars on the vertical, we have quantity of services on the horizontal, and do you see the fixed expense? And on top of the fixed expense, you have variable expenses. So everything underneath that variable expense line, you can think of that as your total cost. Revenue in this environment starts at zero, because if you're a physician and you don't provide any services, you do not get paid. But as you provide services, you make more money. As long as you have a positive contribution margin, at some point you are going to intersect that variable expense line. And what is the natural incentive after you've hit that break-even point? Natural incentive is to do more, right? Because that's when you make more profit. You want to hurry and get to that break-even point as quickly as possible, and then provide more, because that's how you make more money as a provider, as a facility. And that kind of ties into exactly what we've seen, right? We have a system where costs have outstripped everything else. So CMS came in and said, well, let's change up some of the incentives. And so they instituted a prospective payment system in about 1982, 1983. Some of you may see this, may be familiar with this. These are your DRGs, diagnosis-related groups. And what they did is they took these treatment patterns and they grouped them into clinically similar areas. And they said, for everything that falls into this clinically similar area, we're going to pay you some fixed dollar amount. So we're going to take away your incentive to to provide lots and lots of services. There are some challenges with these DRG payments in that you're still paid per episode. So every time you go to the hospital, you have been paid for that encounter. Not everything that you do at the hospital. So think of it as kind of you're paying for every taco, every time you go to the Taco Bell. Under fee-for-service, when you went to Taco Bell, you'd have to pay for the taco shell, the lettuce, the cheese, the sawdust and meat. Those are the things that you would have. That was a fee-for-service environment. So they said, we're going to kind of pull everything together, and it's now going to be one unit. But we still pay at the unit level. And you can see the incentive at that individual consumption point. Same fixed expense, same variable expense, but the revenue is fixed. And in this environment, the incentive is to do just the opposite of a fee-for-service environment. Fee-for-service is do lots of stuff. In a prospective payment model, the incentive is to do as little as possible. You make more profit as a physician. If I'm getting $100 per month to take care of a patient, I actually don't want to see that patient. Because I'm getting the $100 regardless of whether I see him or not. If they come in and utilize services, then I'm eating into my profit. So CMS recognized this challenge and they said, you know, we need to change, we need to fundamentally shift the way that we pay for healthcare. And we're specifically talking about how facilities are going to be paid. Physicians is a slightly different reimbursement model. So what they did is with the Deficit Reduction Act in 2005 and with the ACA in 2000, they said we are going to pay facilities not just on how many encounters that they have, but we're going to start thinking about value. We're going to pay them more if they have a positive patient experience. If they're above average from a patient experience perspective, if they adhere to clinical processes of care, if their outcomes are better than average, and if they're really efficient with their services, we're going to reward them for it. But they also said if you are below average, you're going to get penalized. So it is a budget neutral process. It means all your winners are going to have to be offset by losers. Magnitude is exactly the same. And the program started off as a voluntary program in 2012 and became mandatory in 2013. Like I've mentioned, it is budget neutral, and it's important to keep in contact the overall environment. So within this environment, hospitals are not making money hand over fist. In fact, your government hospitals have a zero margin. They're not making any money at all. Your not-for-profit institutions, like your IHCs of the world, they're generally in that 1% to 3% margin range, which is not great, right? Dollars is slightly different. It's a big dollar amount because they have so much revenue coming through, but from a margin perspective, it's pretty thin. If you were to invest in a security and that security, you would buy a stock, if that security were to only generate a 1% or 2% return, you would not be happy or the stock would not go up, okay? And then your for-profit institutions, they have a slightly higher margin. But in general, within facilities, there's not a whole lot of flexibility. So we're talking about paying these facilities a little bit less than what they're currently making, and that has the potential to drive them out of business. It has the potential to make them less profitable than they currently are and actually drive them into a negative margin. So what we did and what we're interested in, this is building on some of the earlier research that we've done, is we wanted to know how much movement is there within these adjustments. So do they, if you receive a positive adjustment in 1 year, are you likely to receive a positive adjustment the following year? If you're a winner, do you stay a winner? If you're a loser, do you stay a loser? And this is done with some colleagues of mine, Stephen Howard, who's also at St. Louis. He's running our executive program. Kevin is leaving us. He's going to be the program director and associate chair at the University of Pittsburgh. Kenton is coming to us from Blue Cross Blue Shield. And Travis is a graduate student who is interested in pursuing some of this research. So within the constellation, this is an eye chart. You're not intended to read all of it. But what I wanted to illustrate with this slide is that CMS is making this transition across the spectrum. So 30% of all of CMS's, all of Medicare's payments, are going to have some sort of value component by 2018. Now they've already hit that metric, and now they're shooting for, I think, 70 to 75% by 2020 or thereabouts. So that there's going to be a value component. There's going to be something else on top of just the encounter data that's going to influence whether or not you get paid and how much you get paid. And the program that we looked at specifically was this hospital value-based purchasing program up here, top one in from the right. And that program is going to put at risk up to 2% of all your Medicare revenue. 2%. Now keep in mind, your margin is only 1 to 3%, and Medicare is accounting for your largest portion of your book of business, right? So if your book of business, Medicare on average is going to be somewhere between 40 and 60% of all your revenue. So they're talking about putting a ton of your revenue at risk. They have the potential to drive you into the red, but there are a lot of other programs that are going on at the same time. You have hospital-acquired conditions. You had readmission penalties. The one that's taking up a lot of time for administrators is this comprehensive joint replacement program. But again, you can kind of see this is happening across a whole bunch of different providers, a whole bunch of different platforms. Now, there clearly has to be evidence for this, right? Why would CMS make this push towards value-based purchasing? Or I may refer to it as pay for performance if there isn't a whole lot of literature supporting it. Turns out that the literature is pretty mixed on it. So you may hear me refer to it as pay for performance or value-based purchasing. Value-based purchasing is the same thing as P4P or pay for performance. The only difference is that value-based purchasing is from the government perspective, P4P is from the private sector. Literature, everything, overlap is fairly significant. But the literature says, you know, this P4P stuff, this value-based purchasing, it's not necessarily generating the type of return that we want. If I'm going to pay you for value, I want to make sure that the patients are having a better experience and that their outcomes are better. Turns out, at least from some of the other stuff that's been done, it's not so great. In fact, there's some of our earlier literature showed that there was no impact to quality of care or to outcomes with the hospital value-based purchasing program. Okay. But where we have seen it be effective, so in those instances where it is effective, the population that's being targeted is very narrow. So we are only going to deal with diabetic patients over 65 in this zip code, right? Very narrow population that you can wrap your arms around from a managerial perspective. I can develop a program that will be effective for that population. But if you're asking me to make everyone within this three zip codes healthy, that's a tougher proposition. So the value-based purchasing program itself is composed right now of four large categories. Categories you'll see on the left, right? So this is your patient experience. Patient experience is pulled from your HCAHPS scores, adherence to clinical processes of care, your outcomes measures, and then your efficiency. In the first year of the program, 2013, what they said is, we're going to weight 30% of your overall adjustment is going to be a direct result of how your patients feel about their encounter, the patient experience. 70% is going to be whether or not you did the appropriate thing at the appropriate time. And early on, we're only going to put 1% of your total revenue at risk, of your total Medicare revenue at risk. 2014, things are changing. They're adding an additional domain. Things are getting a little bit more difficult. They're adding outcomes in addition. So here's a question for you. Why not just care about outcomes? Yeah.
You could end up spending way too much money just to get a marginally better outcome.
Okay.
So you have to consider costs and resources.
And so that's exactly what they did in 2015. So they added efficiency, which is Medicare spending per beneficiary. But all right, let's keep efficiency, let's keep outcomes. why bother with patient experience or adherence to evidence-based medicine? Why keep that at all? Yeah.
Well, you want to offer quality service rather than, I mean, you want to see the patient as a person, not just a statistic.
Yeah, okay. But if they get better, you know, from a payer perspective, if they isn't the end goal of the payer system to make sure that they get better? Why include additional metrics? A lot of it has to do with the natural variation associated with the outcomes measures. Because you can treat the patient exactly the way that they need to be treated. And you can do everything appropriately. Right? You gave them the medicine at the appropriate time, at the appropriate place, setting, everything was perfect. But yet they still had that adverse event. There's natural variation within the population. If you only look at the outcomes, you're taking away some of that natural variation. Moreover, we're missing, to some degree, issues with patient choice. Patient choice is not necessarily reflected in the outcomes. Because they could decide, hey, you know, I've just been discharged from the hospital, I had this heart attack, I'm feeling great, I'm going to go down to Chili Cheese Dog and watch the Cardinals game. Or watch the BYU game. You guys don't have Chili Cheese Dog. But that's not exactly what they, and it goes into overtime, right? Not exactly what the cardiologist would recommend for patient care. And so that's why CMS has added some of these other dimensions and the other metrics to look at value. Yeah.
So does patient experience somewhat include like education of the patient?
So you can see the HCAHPS data that they're pulling is nurse communication, doctor communication. I think discharge planning, discharge information is a portion of that. And then the overall experience with the encounter. So that's some of the information that they're pulling. Mm-hmm. It's not perfect, but it's already in existence. So CMS, rather than force them to invent new information and new metrics, uses HCAHPS scores because they're already there. Okay. One of the other things to pay attention to, remember what I said about how they tend to be very narrow and focused when they're really effective? We have a ton of measures, right? We have four domains, soon to be five, because in 2017, they have added safety, right, with a bunch of additional metrics. And so we have a ton of metrics, lots of different categories, and through time, we've seen each one of these areas be downweighted. So your adherence to clinical processes of care started off at 70%, and now it's 10. So from a managerial perspective, this is crazy talk, right? You want me to do what? You want me to make sure that my satisfaction scores are high, and you want me to do some catheter, make sure I've got all my catheters and surgeries and pneumonia and influenza, and I have to do all of that stuff every year, and we have stuff dropping in and dropping out all the time. So just with clinical processes of care, which accounts for 10% of your overall score, we have influenza, your shots, your vaccines, new in 2016. You have stuff drop in 2014, so surgery patients with thromboembolism prophylaxis order drops in 2014 and drops out in 2016. Right? So from a managerial perspective, this is becoming really cumbersome. There's a lot you're asking me to do. So is it worth it? Well, I can't tell you whether it's worth it or not until I give you some idea of how it's scored. And the way it works is you are scored essentially 1 to 100, 0 to 100. 100 is you are at the top end of the distribution. You're doing everything better than everyone else. 0, you're at the bottom end of the distribution. And you are indexed against all the other facilities that are out there. In each one of those particular areas, each one of those metrics, you are going to be scored. Now, you don't want to penalize people at the bottom end of the distribution because then you take away their incentive to participate, right? If I'm at the bottom, why would I play in this game? Because I know I'm just going to get penalized. So they said, you know, we still want to encourage you to participate and improve, so we're going to give you some points for improving. And it's based off of kind of a benchmark, some point in your history, and if you improve, you're going to get some additional scores. But the takeaway is, each one of those domains is added together, and you come up with an overall score, 0 to 100. 100 means you're going to receive the full positive adjustment from CMS, and if you're at 0, it means you're going to get the full 2% penalty from CMS. What did we do? Well, we pulled all the hospitals that are out there. So there are a little over 2,500 hospitals that participated in the program from 2013 through 2016. And you can see the general makeup, 74% are in urban locations. You see teaching facilities account for about 30% of the sample. Your systems, so these are hospitals that are part of a system, so TEMP. And what are some of the other IHC hospitals around here? Those would all be the system-affiliated facilities. So that accounts for about 46% of the overall sample. Not-for-profit is pretty close to what the national average is. It's 63%. IOs, and then the reason it doesn't quite add up is that you've got some government hospitals that are not included in this. Any of your critical access facilities, they're not a part of your part of the data. They're not participating in the value-based purchasing program. And the average number of hospital beds, it's a little north of 200. So that's the average size of the hospital. And we pulled all this information directly from the Medicare cost reports and as well as some of the area attributes we can kind of back into. So where are we seeing the volatility in the scores? First off, we calculated a relative risk ratio. For public health, relative risk ratios, this is right in your wheelhouse, right? You should be able to calculate this pretty easily. And what we see is that 2013-2014, the relative risk ratio, where the exposure is whether or not you received a positive adjustment, the relative risk ratio was 3.1, meaning you are a whole lot more likely to receive a positive adjustment in 2014 if you received a positive adjustment in the prior year. But you can see as the program begins to mature, as we add more metrics into this evaluation, that relative risk ratio drops down. Now keep in mind, relative risk ratio is of 1 is essentially a flip of the coin. Right? You are almost as likely to receive a penalty as a benefit in the 2015-2016. So over the life of the program, we've gone from something where winners have stayed winners to a program where the winners may win, they may not in the following year. So the question is, what's driving some of that volatility? If you look at the individual domain scores, and keep in mind these domain scores are 0 to 100 with 50 being average, you can see the standard deviation of the scores. So we've got the patient experience. That's pretty significant. There's still a lot of volatility, a lot of movement. That's your standard deviation of just the patient experience piece. But the vast majority of it comes in your outcomes measures and in your efficiency measures. Now, those of you who are statistically inclined, that 22.12 that you're seeing with the efficiency measures, that is probably an artifact of the fact that you only have 2 years in the sample. That I would anticipate that the efficiency number coming down with the 2017 data. But takeaway is outcomes and efficiency are driving this volatility within the hospital payment. Questions? Okay, I'll continue. Now we're going to move over to the financing stuff, right? So the public health people, they get the relative risk ratio. Finance people don't. They like this type of a model. So this is a time series model, a dynamic panel model with time invariant fixed effects. So those who are econ or stat. There are a couple different ways of talking about it, but we're all talking about essentially the same model, just slightly different vernacular. It is an autoregressive function, which means it's going to do some funny things through its standard errors. So we had to do some clustering of the standard errors, Huber-wide estimations. But the model itself says your adjustment in any given year is a function of how big your adjustment was in the prior year. So we would anticipate if you have 100% persistence from one year to the next, the beta coefficient should be a 1. Meaning if you received a full 1.5% adjustment positive, you should see, if you have a beta of 1, you should see the full potential adjustment in the following year. Now we had to adjust the dependent variable because again we went from a 1% adjustment to a 2% adjustment with a 0.25% per year for the first 4 years of the program. But we got around that by standardizing and putting it in terms of the total potential adjustment in the given year. 100% of the adjustment, 50% of the adjustment, 25% of the adjustment. So you took 1.5% penalty in 2015 divided by 1.5. That was the total potential in that year, so you had a potential score of 100%. That was 100% adjustment. If you only received a 1.5 adjustment the following year, when it was 1.75, that adjustment was something smaller. You received 0.75 or thereabouts of the potential adjustment from period to period. So we did take into account the moving dependent variable. We use this a lot in stock valuations, and we use it in some of the earnings smoothing literature. I will present to you two platforms. First is the within-group estimates, and then the between-group estimates. So remember, a beta of 1 means that 100% of your adjustment is carrying forward from one period to the next. Winners are staying winners, losers are staying losers. But that's not what we see. We see that 13% of your adjustment from period to period is being held over. And that makes sense with some of the relative risk ratio that we saw, right? Started off at 3.1, it's now down to just over 1. Well, our dynamic panel model indicates the same thing. If you look at the between group estimates, and what we're doing here is you're looking at systems relative to non-systems. You're looking at not-for-profit relative to for-profit. You're looking at non-teaching relative to teaching. And the way to interpret these beta coefficients is that systems are actually less effective at holding on to their adjustment from one period to the next than non-systems. Not that they are performing poorly or more poorly than non-systems, it's just that they're holding on to less of that adjustment from period to period. Some of that may be that they're just not as efficient. Some of it may be that these systems are starting off at a higher point and you're seeing some regression to the mean. There are a whole host of potential stories for it. But the takeaway is, yeah, they're all significant, but they're not terribly substantial, right? So this is 0.0064 of a 2% adjustment of 40% of your book. So once you start putting them in those terms, we're not talking about moving around a ton of money when you look at the between group estimates. All right. So there are a couple of big takeaways that I think are important for us. First is the average adjustment is centered on zero. And what we've seen is that as the number of metrics has increased, people have begun aggregating tighter and tighter on that zero. So it used to be that there was more distribution associated with the value-based purchasing program. So it was harder to go from a 1% penalty to a 1% positive payment, right? But now that as they add more metrics, it's harder to distinguish yourself. It's much more difficult to be at the bottom on all the metrics. And they're adding more, right? So it's hard to be at the bottom of Medicare spending. It's hard to be at the bottom of patient satisfaction for all of those metrics. But it's also very difficult to be at the top on all metrics. So if you want to receive the full 2% adjustment in any given year, you have to knock the top out of everything. All of those metrics, you have to be at the top. You have to be in the top 10%, or otherwise you're going to start drifting towards that zero-based adjustment. And so we've aggregated, we've put more measures onto the program, but we've essentially pushed people closer and closer to zero. So the question becomes, does it make it worthwhile? And this is where the policy implication is important. These are all great measures. In and of themselves, yeah, I want people to get the drugs at the appropriate time. I want my patients to be satisfied. I want the outcomes to be appropriate. But as we add more and more metrics, I have to invest more and more managerial time to get improvement. If I want the community to have a better outcome, I have to invest time in the community. If I want my facility to have a better outcome and better patient experiences, I have to invest in that particular investment, or I have to in that particular, those particular assets. Well, does it become worthwhile? And some of our earlier research pointed to the fact that these programs, on average, move less than $200,000. Meaning, all these metrics, all these programs, we're talking about less than $200,000. Yeah, $200,000 is a lot of money, I get it. But from a facility that's generating hundreds of millions of dollars per year, $200,000 is a rounding error. So why would they invest a lot of time and effort to improve these particular metrics when there may not be a whole lot of movement? So let's say I improve patient satisfaction scores. That's great. How much of an impact is that going to have on my particular outcome? Because we've seen it go from 30% down to 10 or 70% if we're talking about process of care, from 70% of the overall weight down to 10. So now my ability to actually wag and influence the behavior, it's not necessarily incented by the system. So we have too many metrics that are driving the adjustments, and the value of improvement in any one particular metric, as they add more and more to the pile, the value of improving, it diminishes, and it diminishes pretty quickly. And then finally, some of these measures may actually run counter to each other. So if we go back to, sorry for the whiplash, so if we go back to this overall program, we have Medicare spending per beneficiary. That metric may actually run counter to some of the other items within the program. I want my doctors to spend more time with the patients. I want my nurses to sit down and have a conversation and communicate effectively, do the discharge plan. But that doctor time, that nursing time requires money, right? Time which equals money. And so if I want to drive down my Medicare spending per beneficiary, I say, docs, maybe a 15-minute conversation at the end of your visit isn't the best use of your time. But that 15-minute conversation is what was driving up their patient satisfaction scores. And so we have a system where it may actually be built such that you cannot attain you cannot physically top out, right? Because the measures are working against each other. They're pushing people towards that zero adjustment, which is not good if you are wanting the positive adjustment. It's great if you are getting hit with a penalty. And so some of the system may actually be built such that, people at the top end are going to continue to try and compete and be at the top end. We want to get people at the bottom end of the distribution, the people who are, the facilities who are performing poorly, we want to see whether we can get them to improve their performance. And we have seen some of that. So we have seen the overall distribution move up. We've seen the outcomes, the patient satisfaction move up a little bit, but not necessarily when it comes to the outcomes. That goes back to that P4P stuff that I was talking about. Some of these areas, you can see some improvements, adherence to process of care. Yeah, we see some slightly better adherence, but the outcomes themselves aren't necessarily improving. And we found that with our literature, and then the GAO, shortly thereafter, Government Accountability Office, found the same thing, where they're not seeing an improvement in quality and it's not necessarily saving the system money. So questions or comments on the idea? Yeah.
So are there ways to collapse down the metrics into maybe measure all of that, but score it based on kind of more combined, you know, is this person healthier than when they came in? And
so the answer is probably yes. But what they've done is they've taken each one of those submetrics and they're aggregating those at the domain level. And so they would say, yeah, we're doing that at the domain level. I think what you're referring to is maybe a more holistic approach, but then we get away from the value of P for P, which is supposed to be very targeted, right? If we transition from targeted to a more holistic, then your resolution, your ability to affect that outcome diminishes. Yeah.
Is this applied across the board to all medical treatments, or are cardiologists different from cancer doctors or whatever? Is this across the board, everybody?
So this is for all facilities. So we're only talking about the hospitals themselves. When you go in and you are treated, the hospital's bill separate from the facility, right? And there's a whole new system that we're seeing with MACRA and they're trying to, again, they're trying to transition even physicians to a value-based purchasing program. Right? That is in the works and it's being rolled out. This is only for the facilities. So yeah, you go in and maybe they do an ablation, maybe they do something on your heart. The facility charges is what we're talking about.
Do you know if there are geographic distributions to winning and losing? Because it seems like rural healthcare providers, for example, would be more likely to be in.
Yeah. So
there are other geographic clusters. I saw you had urban there.
Yeah. So again, this isn't necessarily whether they're scoring better. Mm-hmm. This is whether or not they're holding on to more of their adjustment from period to period. Mm-hmm. What I can tell you from some of our earlier research is no. There is not a big difference. And I thought there would be, right? Mm-hmm. But the takeaway is, if they're so rural that they don't have enough volume, they're not going to be included in the program, or they'll be critical access, in which case they're not a part of the program. But if they're big enough to have enough throughput, no, there isn't a significant difference between either the quality of care as measured by these metrics, or the adjustment doesn't influence their financial profitability. Because that was something that we were interested in too. Does this adjustment really move the needle? Does it make a profitable firm more profitable or less profitable? And are the profitable firms better at this than the non-profitable firms? And the answer is no, on both firms, front end and back end. Yeah.
So you may have already mentioned this, but just to kind of tie it all together, how do they decide on what was it again?
The value-based purchasing?
Yeah, how do you decide, we're going to focus on this this year, we're going to add this, because it kind of just looks like, well, this looks important, so let's throw it in, but it just...
I think there is a certain amount of that, if I'm being honest. A lot of these, there is some evidence that, hey, if you focus on it, you can improve outcomes. The problem is that you get enough of these things, then it becomes less meaningful because you're just trying to do too much.
Yeah.
It's too hard to do all of the patient satisfaction plus all of the provider. It becomes too cumbersome. They would say there's clearly evidence for this, otherwise we wouldn't throw it into the model. The problem is when you throw it into the model with everything else, its impact diminishes.
Yeah.
So we've talked a little bit about the program. As far as my own research moving forward, I needed to get this in the literature. So not necessarily the relative risk ratio, but that dynamic panel model, the persistence and volatility. My goal is to get that into the literature so that I can use it for a handful of other factors, right? So how volatile, how persistent are earnings, efficiency, nursing ratios, staffing ratios. There's a whole slew of potential avenues to use this model for. We use it in finance. It is not used within the health services research yet. I'm trying to get that fixed. The other things that I'm spending quite a bit of time on, I've got a chapter coming out with the Health Administration Press on global healthcare finance, global systems. I've been asked to update some community benefit legislation. That should be coming out here in the near future. And as part of my role with some external organizations, I've been asked to give an update on the state of the healthcare finance field. What we're teaching, how we're teaching it, who's teaching it, and whether or not we're doing a halfway decent job. The things that are on the docket of the kind of in the near future would be the impact of double marginalization. So when you have a vertically integrated system like a Geisinger, like an IHC, where you have physicians and the insurance firm and the hospital all part of the same chain, are we recognizing the promise of increased efficiency? Are we able to provide more services at a lower price? Preliminary evidence signals no. And my question is, well, why is that? It doesn't make sense from an economic perspective. So that is something that I'm playing with. And then the other thing that has always bothered me, and no one has really addressed it yet, and so I think there's a clear opportunity, is to talk about the transfer of risk that's happening within healthcare right now. So what we're seeing is that payers and the government are transitioning more and more of the risk onto the providers, onto the health systems, onto doctors, onto clinics. And in general, that's okay, right? So I'm going to transfer health status risk. And then kind of think of health status risk as a probability of falling ill, right? This is one of the primary goals of public health. What can we do to reduce health status risk? What can we do to reduce the probability of someone falling ill? Medical care risk, you can kind of think of that as the other side of the Bayesian statistic, right? Now that you've fallen ill, how much is it going to cost to make you better? Okay. And then the final one is underwriting risk, and that has to do with the volume. So if you have a very small population that you're trying to treat, pediatric nephrology, for example, you're going to see a lot of variation in the potential payments and the potential expenses. All of that risk is being shifted onto providers. And my question is whether or not providers are actually being compensated for that risk. Because I can tell you, I'm happy to take on risk. As a former insurance guy, I'll give it to me. I'm happy to give it. But I'm going to charge you a premium for it. That's the deal. In exchange for taking on risk, right, the contingent risk of you getting sick and falling ill and needing care, for taking on that risk, you have to pay me associated premium. We haven't had that discussion within healthcare. We shift the risk onto providers and onto systems, but there is no associated payment. So that is those are kind of the things on my docket that I hope to get to within the next couple of months. So with that, I think I've overshot by a couple of minutes, but I'm happy to entertain any questions.
All right, any other questions? Okay, let's give them a hand. Thank you.